The real entrepreneur says, I can fail, but I'm going to keep going. It's okay. Doesn't matter. Just keep going. Right. It's going to happen. And I can tell you, every time I walk through the process of starting something new or beginning another chapter in my life, I didn't even ask the question, what do I do if this fails? I just look at it and go, there's a chance it's going to fail.
I'm Zach Hall, and this is the Mindset Movement.
All right, guys, welcome back into the next episode of the Mindset Movement. I'm here today with Michael Robison, and I'm super, super pumped to have this guy on the show today, because if you're going to ask me my opinion of him, he's a business strategy expert. He's really a corporate communications expert. The guy's just an overall beast when it comes to business coaching. Mike, how are you doing today?
Good. I'm glad I get to be a part of this. Thank you for having me.
Honestly, thanks for coming on. Thanks for coming on, man. And we'll just start it off here. Where are you from?
Originally, I am from Nashville. So I'm a Southern guy, Southern born and raised, and love Nashville. Although currently I live in Los Angeles, and I love being out here. I love being in the city. Let's put it that way. Nashville is growing. It's big. It's great. It's wonderful. It's a great place to grow up and cut my teeth in the world. But being in the big city is definitely where I love being the most.
Right. No, that's good, man. I respect that. So what is it you do, man? I know what it is, but for like the viewers, everybody out there listening, like if you had to describe it, like what is it you do with D5 Group over there?
Absolutely. Well, here's the interesting thing. This is kind of the best way. I do business communications consulting, and that applies across a whole different breadth of practices and applications. Obviously, in the business world, that can be anything from, you know, marketing and content strategy communications. But what I most often end up doing, and it really wasn't what I set out to do, but I have found myself in this place where I call it marriage counseling for executives. I find myself around the boardroom with the C-suite, whether it's the president, the VP level, the managers, that kind of stuff, the owners of the company. And I basically help them learn to communicate with one another, like get on the same page, speak the same language, start sharing values together. Like it's a really fun process. And I never intended that was exactly what I was going to do. But because of my really unique and diverse background, I ended up in this place where I love people and I love relationships, but I love brand strategy, marketing strategy, communication strategy, content strategy. And I found this really interesting space where the two come together. And so most of the time, what I find myself doing is getting in a room and helping executives and teams begin to communicate with clarity, which then is, you know, what really becomes awesome then is like nothing gets in your way when you speak the same language, when you start moving in the same direction. So you unlock momentum, you know, possibility, people start dreaming together, you bring cohesiveness together, team culture. It's a really unique and fun process that I get to be involved with my clients.
And I know you're an industry leader when it comes to your space there, because that's obviously how I found you. That's how we integrated up and got on the show here together. Super pumped to have you, like I said, again. But I mean, like, when you got into this, man, like, I got to ask you, was it something that was kind of like passion driven, or was it maybe like money driven? Like, what actually kickstarted you to get into this? Were you like pushed into it because you wanted to like start making money? Like, obviously, money is a big part of just about any business.
Yeah, everybody wants to make money.
Exactly. But was it where you like were almost like pushed into it because you were solving all these problems and it turned into a business? You see what I'm saying?
Right. Absolutely. So, you know, my background is really interesting, is that I've been in sales and leadership, and then just a kind of a serial entrepreneur. I started my first business like in college, and, you know, just kind of continued to do that over and over again in different ways. And I'm always looking for a project. I know before we started recording, I told you I've got a couple of, you know, cure my boredom projects that are coming down the pike, but
we're gonna wake up on those.
That's right, man. We totally are. You're my man for this. So, you know, but being the guy who owned and ran different businesses was always an interesting thing. So it gave me an interesting look at what was needed in the operations, communication, sales, marketing, content, all those sorts of things. And then I found myself after a certain season of time actually working in an agency environment for a few years where I was a strategic consultant. And so I got into these basically project management consulting things. And so what really happened was my passion and my experience for having been the guy who was running things or needed the expertise to being the guy who was giving, I wouldn't say giving expertise, but being paid to show up and run my mouth in the room. As I sat with these teams and I had some pretty impressive clients during that season, that's kind of how I discovered this space, because what happened is I got into the room with, you know, some of these Fortune 500, these billion-dollar, you know, multi-billion-dollar corporate environments, and found this very specific niche need with these teams where they just were not capable and able to communicate with one another effectively, and it affected the business. I had one client in particular that when I stepped in, I mean, they had 35 people involved in the decision-making process in this company, and they needed to relaunch and scale a particular niche inside the business. And this is a $12 billion a year revenue engine. And it took a while, it took a few months. But within 6 months, we had the engine moving. 21 months after we started, we took them from 28 million a year to over 600 million a year in revenue generation in that particular project. And it really all boiled down to effective communication strategies.
That's insane. That's honestly something to be really proud of right there. Yeah. And you may have already hit it on this, but how long have you been doing it again?
Yeah. So I don't even know the answer to that question, to be honest with you. I mean, it's one of those things. I took an official role doing this stuff in 2014, working for someone else. And since 2016, I've been doing it for myself. Gotcha. So, you know, I would say effectively in this, like to call it what I call it, to do exactly what I do, I'd say I've been at this for a little over 5 years. The interesting thing is, though, from a communications and leadership standpoint, I've been doing this since about 2001.
Right. That's what I was picking up on when I was talking with you before. Like, you're saying 2014. I'm like, well, we got a 13-year gap there. But no, that's what I thought. You've been in this space a long, long time. It's a long time to really do anything. And since this is one of the earlier episodes here, we got to be honest with ourselves. Most people are going to fall off this podcast before it gets further along. So we want to help the beginning entrepreneur, since this is the beginning episodes. When you're starting your business and you're doing what you're doing, like how important, in your opinion, is the actual passion behind what you're doing? Like, could you do this job if you didn't like it?
Well, no, I think you've got to have passion, but it goes beyond passion, because here's something that's really interesting to me. I think we actually get caught in the idea of passion, and we know what that means. I mean, it's a vernacular, it's a syntax thing. Like, we love what we do, and we get up every day and we're excited to go to work, and we want to try this, and sometimes we can't sleep at night because we're thinking about the next thing we want to do. But I think it goes beyond passion, because passion is just an emotion. And if we live on our emotions, you know, it's this roller coaster ride, this up and down. I think what it really comes down to is the successful entrepreneurs who really are going to make a difference and are going to do something, they have this unrelenting obsession. It's not passion, it's obsession, because obsession drives you to actually take action, to actually do the work. You know, passion, some days with passion, it's strong, and some days it's not. Some days I feel like doing it, some days I don't. Obsession drives me into this like obsessive compulsive drive to just work, to keep going, to hustle, to find the next client, to sell the next thing, to, you know, whatever it is, the obsession drives me to just keep going, even on the hardest days. And it keeps me going. Like, the really successful guys that we see out there, their obsession is so strong that even when they're winning, even when they make the win, they don't stop the hustle. Like, they keep moving through it. Like, those are the guys you have to go, dude, you just made, like, you won, slow down, celebrate, take a minute, breathe, enjoy this. And they're like, no, I got to keep going. And so I would say that it goes beyond the passion. It has to exist somewhere in the realm of obsession.
Okay. No, I'll honestly 100% agree with you on that. That's pretty similar to what my answer would be. I'm going to even come out and tell you this. I didn't tell you this earlier when we were talking. I didn't sleep last night. I do that regularly. Some people say it's bad for your health. When you get into REM sleep studies, you really don't need a full 8 hours of sleep like most people say at night. You just got to reach REM sleep or whatever. That's a whole different argument. But the point I'm trying to get at here is I don't sleep very much myself. I probably 2-3, sometimes 4 nights a week where I just work straight through the night. And it's not because, again, it's not passion driven.
Yeah.
In a sense, it is. It goes deeper than that, though, like you're saying. It's obsession. I absolutely just love what I'm doing.
Yeah.
And I completely nailed that answer with what you gave there, which was going to lead me right into the next question I had for you. Like, how much do you sleep?
Yeah. Well, I mean, it's an interesting, it varies, but not very much. I would say that, you know, my typical sleep pattern is anywhere between 3 to 5 hours a night. You know, that's just me. Like I'm the type, my routine will vary from time to time. I'm in a season right now. You know, for a good portion of my life, I was the guy, I got up at 4 o'clock in the morning, hit the gym, work out, you know, come home, shower, clean up, grab my coffee. And then I'm heads down, like for the next 4 to 8 hours, I'm heads down getting stuff done. But generally what that would lend itself to is by noon, 1 o'clock in the afternoon, I've finished work. You know what I'm saying? Like the busy work, the get crap done, you know, make stuff happen. Like that way what happens is in the afternoon hours is when I do a lot of the personal one-on-one connecting, make my phone calls, you know, do that kind of stuff, my networking. Then I would take a break. And then usually by dinner time, somewhere in there, I'm back heads down, getting ready for what's been, you know, what's coming ahead the next day. And then find myself in bed by midnight. What's been really interesting is now I've shifted, and I don't know if this comes with age, that I'm pushing 40 now. So, you know, call me old, but you know, I'm starting to get this place where, I'm actually enjoying getting up in the mornings, and instead of hitting the gym first thing, getting up and grabbing my coffee when I get out of bed, going heads down, creatively writing, you know, creating content, all sorts of different things. And then my break in the day, kind of my rest period, is actually when I hit the gym. I think it's where I kind of collect my thoughts and I get going. But again, it's still driven by embedded, you know, now I'm probably in bed between midnight, 1 o'clock in the morning, and I'm up by 5, 6 o'clock in the morning. So still that 3 to 5 hour sleep pattern.
And I hear it's a common thing that a lot of people talk about when they talk about being a successful entrepreneur. If you're going to start your own business, like, you got to wake up early. Everybody says that, right?
Yeah.
It, in my opinion, it completely depends on, what's that called, your sleep chronotype?
Yeah.
Four,
yeah.
One.
Yeah.
It sounds like you're more so like a bear. They label them as bear, lion, wolf, and dolphin. And then four. And it sounds like you're, I might have this mixed up, but it sounds like you're like a bear. Like, you get the big bulk of your important work done early to mid morning.
Yep.
And then usually like you'll retire in early at night. Like, you'll probably go to bed 10, 11 o'clock at night, I'm assuming, just so you can get up in the morning, because that's your most productive time. Right.
Right.
So a common thing that I wanted to get across on this subject to everybody else that's listening is you don't necessarily have to wake up early. It's kind of a common misconception across the board that everybody talks about. You just got to figure out what your sleep chronotype is and adjust your schedule with that. Like, you want to work within what works for you.
Right.
My chronotype, I'm a wolf. So almost completely opposite from you in a sense, where most times when I do sleep, I sleep in later.
Yeah.
And I don't actually start to get my important stuff done until mid-afternoon and night. Like, I work the best when it's actually dark out and there's no distractions and nothing around.
Yep.
So.
No, I totally get that. And I think people have to figure that out. There's not one formula to the right entrepreneurial schedule during the day. I think the biggest thing is the proper time management and focus. And I think where a lot of guys miss the mark is they're not creating space and time to focus to get the work done. They're focused on the dream and the idea of doing something, and they love the idea of being successful, but they're not willing to actually put in the heavy work to make it happen. And so when you make that space, whether it's early mornings or late at night, but where you can be driven and focused and your head, you know, heads down, your eyes are on the prize, you know, that kind of thing. Like, I don't care if, you know what, I don't care if you sleep 14 hours a day. If, you know, the other 10 hours a day, you have life balance, like, you actually enjoy your life and you're getting work done. It doesn't, like, everybody's going to be different. Nothing fits for everybody. You know, you look at the, you know, famous guys, the Einsteins and the Edisons and, you know, all these guys who came before, like, and everybody's done all those studies on their sleep patterns. They all did. They all just operated very differently and it worked for them.
Yep. Jeff Bezos, he doesn't show up to his Amazon headquarters office until I think it's 10 a.m. or 11 a.m. Same thing with Elon Musk.
Yeah.
But Warren Buffett, he wakes up early in the morning and starts reading probably 5 hours before those guys get up.
Yeah.
So exactly. Like you said, it just depends on who you are and like how you actually function.
That's right.
But I think we really nailed everything there on the sleep part. But let's jump over back into like the actual nitty-gritty important stuff here with the entrepreneurship, because this is a really big one, and I was waiting to get you on the show here so I could ask you specifically this question. But how important, because I know your answer, but I'm excited to hear what you're going to say to everybody else.
Yeah.
But how important is failure to business, in your opinion? Like, how important is it to fail?
It's absolutely integral. Like, I, you know, here's the thing. I think failure is where we learn our greatest lessons, and that's where we gain our biggest strength. And, you know, over the years, I've had some great success, but I've had some epic failure. And I, you know, that's been a key marker in my journey, and it's just life in general. Like, if I succeed, I succeed big. If I fail, I fail big, you know? And, they don't feel good. Don't get me wrong. I'll probably have plenty more failures along the journey. Like, you know, nobody gets to the point where you're so good you quit failing. I think you find out where your limitations are, and you find out where you don't have limitations, because you see how strong you are. You find out how resilient you are. You have the chance to look in the mirror and become self-aware. You discover new things about yourself and about others around you. You find out who your friends are. You know, you go through these things, and it's. I just think it's really important. And you know, when I look at young leaders, in particular, and young entrepreneurs who haven't walked through that failure yet, you know, there's a beauty to some extent of having that sense of the world is so good, and I've never experienced anything negative. And it is that naivety is wonderful. But actually, a really good entrepreneur maintains that same sense of naivety even in the face of failure, because your attitude. Then I think this is what sets the real entrepreneur apart. The real entrepreneur says, I can fail, but I'm going to keep going. It's okay. It doesn't matter. Just keep going. Right. It's going to happen. And I can tell you, every time I walk through the process of starting something new or beginning another chapter in my life, I didn't even ask the question, what do I do if this fails? I just look at it and go, there's a chance it's going to fail.
If the question is, do I really want to do this? It should never be a plan B. It's only a plan A.
Right. Exactly. That's exactly.
You know what I mean? Like, if you fall forward, like
that's right.
Denzel Washington said that.
Yeah,
you're gonna fall forward, because it hurts a hell of a lot less when you can actually see what you're gonna hit.
That's exactly right.
You're falling forward when you're failing your way forward, right?
That's right.
So this is a big thing I teach, because I mentor a lot of people with online e-commerce, and a big thing I teach is a startup curve. But kind of go back a little bit to like a real life example for myself, like. When I was starting off, I scaled very, very quick in the beginning, which sometimes can be bad in business, because you want to obviously keep up with the failures, because business is literally the definition of business, if you ask me, is just nonstop problem solving. That's all it is.
Yeah.
Just nonstop problem solving. So I scaled really, really fast. And a big problem I ran into is PayPal holding up a lot of money on me. So PayPal held up $25,000 from me. And I still haven't even got all of it back. I never will, but it's a pivotal moment. And that's the defining moment for most entrepreneurs right there. Like when you hit rock bottom, like you think you hit rock bottom before, but when you really hit rock bottom, that's going to define who you are. Are you going to keep going, or are you going to quit?
That's right.
And what I see so many people nowadays that are starting entrepreneurship is they're going in with a plan B. They're saying, I'll try this. If I fail, I understand failure is a part of it, but if I fail, I'm just going to try something different. Like you see people with shiny object syndrome, right? They'll jump from thing to thing to thing to thing.
Yep.
And what happens is there's an actual startup curve.
Yeah.
It's teached to a lot of people, the startup curve, you've probably heard of it.
Yeah.
But it's the same, it's a universal law and a principle for everybody who starts anything. Like you have to fail.
Yes.
You have to fail. So if you quit, then you're just going to revert back to the top.
That's right.
Right? And you're going to start a new business, and the same thing's going to happen. Revert back to the top. You're going to keep wondering, like, why you can't get anything figured out. Like, a lot of people come to me, and they'll be like, I've tried so many things, and I just can never get anything to work. It just keeps failing over and over and over again. And the reality is if you don't quit, and you actually go after something that you like and you're passionate about, then it's going to work. It's not a maybe, it's inevitable, it's guaranteed.
Absolutely.
You know, and it stems further than money too. Like you'll get a lot of people out there that say, I'm not doing it for money. I'm doing it because I like time freedom and I want to retire my parents or whatever.
But
the reality is most people do it for money. So
when
I'm gonna explain the startup curve here in a minute, so I'm holding this little board.
Yeah.
But when you do end up hitting that rock bottom, that pivotal moment I'm talking about, if you're only doing it for money, then you will 100% always quit at that point. It's impossible in the business if you're only doing it for money. I mean, you could be a unicorn, I guess, suppose, out there and get lucky. But if you're only doing it for money, it's never going to work. Because once you lose a bunch of money, which is inevitable, you're going to quit because you're only doing it for money. So why would you keep going, right?
That's right.
So the startup curve here, I'll draw first and then I'll explain it. Okay. Let's see if we can... Gonna get these little points down here.
I love it. Dude, I'm such a visual learner, so I love that you're doing that.
Yeah, yeah. Have you heard of this principle before?
Absolutely.
Okay, I figured you did.
No, but I do appreciate you saying that I think you get into it just on the drive for money. And again, finances is a great motivation. But if money is your primary motivation, if you don't, you know, when you have those low moments, you're done, like you're zapped and the motivation ends and you end and you've thrown away the time, experience, and, you know, success or failure, whichever comes with it. And, you know, because money doesn't flow at all seasons. You know, I mean, I've had years where I've made high six figures and higher income, and I've had years where I've made below five figure income. I mean, it just, there is a reality of the way finances work and the way finances move. And so if it's your only driving factor, eventually it changes. And industries and commerce change and the economy gets affected by things. And, you know, again, if money's your driving factor, then you're now a slave to so many external forces that are going to keep you from finding satisfaction, contentment, and happiness in your journey as an entrepreneur.
You're right. Okay, so I got it all wrote up here. Now, I'm not an artist. I'm not very good with my penmanship, but we'll see if we can explain this here. We can get a good little visual of it. It's going to probably be back on the camera, but that's okay. So pretty much when you're starting off, right, you got that straight line, and I should add this on here too, like kind of like a little, what do they call those, like the L charts?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, just your baseline.
Yeah, like you got your positive, your negative. I call it like a positivity and negativity chart in this instance, because when you're starting out right there, right?
Yeah.
You're just in a neutral zone. Nothing's happened yet. Like you're getting ready to start, right? And then you find something, and I see this all the time, and I'll use Shopify and dropshipping because that's a big hot thing right now, and it's something I see a lot in. I get a lot of people coming to me wanting me to mentor them and everything. But people will come to me and they'll see that I'm killing it on Shopify, my online stores in general. And they think just because they get me as a mentor is going to project them like to my level, right? Or at least close to it. That's what a lot of people think. But there's two parts to learning. There's the actual knowledge side of it, and there's the experience side of it. So I'm trying to start the next Amazon. I'm not going to be able to do that if Jeff Bezos is my mentor.
Like, right. No, that's exactly right.
I have a hell of a time with him, but I've never crashed and burned on my own, so it's not going to work.
Right.
Right. So this is where a lot of people fall into. They get that initial enthusiasm, so it all spikes right up there, right? And then they go and do it for themselves. They may have the knowledge, but reality sets in, and you're just going to crash. You're going to fall. You're not going to quite hit bottom, but you're going to hit very, very far down there.
Yeah.
That's reality setting in. And this is why it's super, super important to get like a mentor, actually invest money into the correct knowledge prior to this happening. Cause this is universal. It happens everywhere.
That's absolutely true.
Once you hit bottom there, you're not going to be able to afford to spend any more of your time or any more of your money to learn, because now you got to get in the grind phase. You got to work. You literally can't afford to spend any more time or money.
That's right. So,
I don't think I have it wrote on there, but the next little step area there is it's the testing, the scaling, the pivoting moments.
Yeah.
Like you're trying to figure out what's going to pull you back up out of the hole time and money wise.
That's
right. Is most people get another jolt really quickly of that initial enthusiasm, and they think they came across an idea that's going to fix their business.
Everything. Right? Yeah.
Right? So they go all in on 120%. And what really happens is they drop down right there to that that bottom moment again.
That's right.
Which that's your pivotal moment. That's literally the most important part in entrepreneurship. For some people, it takes years to hit there. For me, in my instance, it took 2 to 3 months.
Right.
Some people sooner. But once you hit that moment, that's what defines you. And the people who stay, and if you're doing it for passion driven and other reasons aside from money, if you stay in it, it's going to work.
Right. That's right.
It's going to work. So once it starts to work, every business is obviously backed by a product or a service to some extent. Once you stay in it and you keep testing, you keep optimizing, pivoting, then it's going to start to fit, right? Your product or your service is going to start to fit in the market. And once it starts to fit and you can actually compete, then that's when you scale. You come out of hole, you make all of your money, all of your time back significantly, right?
Yeah.
Business is an investment. We do this, we obviously do it for money because you got to have money, but predominantly, like I'm doing it for like the time, for the investing of the time, because time, money are investments.
Yeah.
You know, if you want to make money in the stock market, you got to invest your money, right?
Yeah.
The same thing with time. If you want to make time back on your time, you got to invest your time.
That's right.
So that's pretty much what I wanted to get across there with the startup curve, because it's such an important thing in the beginning that I don't see anybody really talking about.
Well, here's the thing is it's not sexy to talk about that part of the journey, but the reality is like, it's not always going to work. And the thing it's interesting because I helped do a startup a few years ago in the space and ultimately it didn't fully work out. And you know, what's really interesting is that when it got really, really hard and it got really, really tough, I found out that, you know, and this is a leadership principle that I had to learn. And as much experience as I have, I'm still learning. And I have to admit, you know, places where I had failure or learning or, you know, experience what's a result of the lack of my ability to lead properly sometimes. But when it got really tough, my team basically kind of flipped and went sideways and didn't want to be a part of it anymore because it was hard and because the money wasn't there and because it was difficult. And ultimately, in the end, we made a very early exit out of the company. If we'd have stuck with it, I feel very certain in the long run, it would have been, you know, 10, 11 figure kind of, you know, revenue generating opportunity. But the reality is that, you know, I don't see that as a failure. I actually see it as a huge success for me as I look at the way I lead other people and I, you know, invest in others and my consulting side is now I know what to help other people look for within their team. So it may have been a somewhat costly educational experience for me and a failure, but the truth is I learned in that moment, and especially when you're building a team and you're not just standing on your own, when you hit that bottom, if you and your team, again, are not aligned and ready to move in the right direction, what's going to happen is everybody's affected, not just you. And so we don't spend enough time talking about the preparation for the hard moments. We don't talk about the preparation for what happens when it doesn't look the way you want it to or it doesn't feel the way you want it to. But nothing in life looks and feels the way we want it to all the time. And that's just a life principle. It's not even business or entrepreneurship. That's just literally the human experience. And we get real and raw and honest about it and then come to the table and go, look, like it's sometimes it just like sucks to be an entrepreneur, an owner, a leader, you know, whatever. Like it's not fun. It doesn't feel good. I don't like it. I don't want to be an adult today. I want to be a kid again, you know, let somebody else pay the bills and somebody else do the work. But man, it's just reality. So let's get honest about it, support each other and kind of push each other ahead as we go through the process.
No, you're right. And when you're saying that, going back to a little bit of like what you're saying with your business and what you do and like how you were grinding at first and then you took those failures and you could teach them to other people.
Yeah.
What that reminds me of right there is the California Gold Rush.
Yeah. Right?
So the people who were the most successful during the California Gold Rush, hear me out, this makes sense.
Yeah.
The people who were the best, the ones that made the most money, the most successful people were the ones selling shovels, not the ones digging for gold.
That's right.
Guys that were digging for gold, sure, you'll have a couple of them strike it big, right? But the majority of them didn't.
Right.
Every single person digging for gold needed a shovel, right? So the people who are selling shovels, aka you and me, like I'm teaching people how to do stuff. You're teaching and consulting businesses. Like, you've been through that. You're selling the shovels now.
Yeah.
Right? Rather than doing the actual work. So that's what I think an important thing is. But in order to get to the point where we can sell shovels, we've got to dig for the gold first.
That's a big thing. I think that you just hit on something, and sorry to interrupt, but that's a huge principle. Is there so many people out there, whether it is the guy who's trying to start the business or the guy who's telling somebody how to start the business. But the truth is, until you've been the practitioner, you can't be the consultant to the practitioner, right? Like, it's kind of like, you know, you don't want your heart surgeon reading a book by somebody who's never done open heart surgery, right? Like, you don't want, like, I need to know that the person I'm investing, you know, my finances in because I'm buying a product or I'm buying a service or whatever, has been there and experienced it. They didn't just read some good book. And even in this case, they're not just listening to the podcast and going, oh, that's a great principle. You know, like, they need to go give it a try before they start trying to pontificate and give knowledge. And actually, like, bro, I want to say, like, super mad respect to you, because you are a practitioner. This isn't, you know, I often get the request to come on and do these interviews and talk all the time, because some guys got this idea of a business they're going to start, but they haven't actually done it yet. And I appreciate the fact that you are already on the I've done it, I've been there phase. I've got these experiences, good, bad, indifferent, hard, easy, exciting, whatever, like, been there, done that. So now, as I'm talking about it, it's not just idealistically looking at what it could be. It is, I've been there on the front line. So let's talk about it. Yep. Let's share these experiences, right?
So I want to bring people on who are, like, say, practitioners, people who have actually been out in the field and done stuff. Like, you get, I'll be honest with you, people who are going to nonstop post on their Instagram about how they have a Lamborghini or whatever.
Right.
And I wrote an Instagram blog post not too far back on my website there about why you can't afford one in the first place, right?
Right.
But I won't even try and reach out to those people. Like, if you have a Lambo, cool.
Yeah, whatever. Good for you, but like, so what?
Nonstop. And try and, like, preach, like, intelligence about money. I'm not going to listen to you, and I'm not going to invite you to be on the show. And it's just because they're not practical about the way that they're thinking with that. Like,
that's right.
If you're going to afford a Lamborghini, right, like, let's say the lease payments – we'll go over the blog post some other time. But more of a story, like, you're somebody who didn't do that. And I wanted to get you on here because you post valuable, good content there on your Instagram account and your Facebook as well. You're posting stuff that's actually practical and valuable to the everyday entrepreneur. It's not like you're just posting stuff about how you have a Lamborghini and you do a lot of cool stuff.
Right. Well, you know, what's really interesting is, to me, it's about practicality. I mean, where I live, I actually have no need of a vehicle. I don't even own a car right now at this stage in my life. It's the first time since I was in high school I haven't owned a car. And it's kind of nice, to be honest with you, because it's just one more thing that's simplified in my life. You know, if I need to get somewhere, just, you know, hit Uber and get in the car and go. Like, I don't need to impress somebody with the stuff that I have. And quite honestly, I just don't need to impress anybody because I'm just another person. Like, I'm not that impressive, and I don't need to be that impressive. I either am bringing value to the people that I serve and adding value to the people who are in my circle of influence, or not. I mean, it's just not like, there is no, like, I'm glad that people like me, and don't get me wrong, I've always been driven by being a people pleaser to some extent, but the truth is, I have a great life. I have people who love me. I have a great family and life's good. So if I never achieve another thing in my life, if nothing else gets achieved in my life, I'm content. I'm good. I'm good where I'm at. So I'm just sharing from contentment. I'm sharing from experience and knowledge and trying to help others. And, you know, for me, if nothing else, my father-in-law, when he was still living, one of the things that he said to me that was really, really important, he said, you know, maybe my life just serves as an example of what not to do. And so if nothing else, if that was the best thing that I add to the life, is just to see people like, hey, these are the mistakes and lessons that I learned. Don't go down this path or don't do that. Yeah. Great. That's okay with me. I don't really care whether people like me for my success or appreciate me for my failure. As long as my life adds value to other people, that's what matters most to me.
Nope. You're right. You're right. Another thing too is, I don't know why I'm thinking this, but we're just going to talk because we're a little unorthodox here, so we're not following the script. But there's so many people out there that just overvalue their time. Yeah. I think me and you could probably relate on this. Like, we're guys that, like, we'll do stuff for free. I do stuff for free all the time. Like, I don't believe in actually selling and giving away my content for free. Like, I don't think a course is necessarily immorally wrong. It's just, it's not, if your true mission is to actually make an impact, like, don't sell it. Put it on YouTube, give it away for free.
That's right.
Another blog that I wrote there on my website. You can actually, and I got a video on my YouTube channel that you can actually make more money. In my case, I guess it would be when you actually give your course away for free.
Yeah.
Affiliate and ad revenue and everything. I mean, you're going to reach more people. And, you know, it's just, I see so many people out there that are just overvaluing their time.
That's right.
And that goes in with being a practical person, a practical entrepreneur is, you know, you got to evaluate that. So, like, the starting out entrepreneurs, like, don't chase the Lamborghini, don't chase the fancy house and the Rolex and all that stuff.
And I think recognize that your life, I mean, we're not guaranteed tomorrow. We don't know how long we're going to live, and then that's all fine. But in general, most people are going to live a lot longer than they anticipate and have a lot more time to do some of those things in life. And something my grandfather taught me when I was a kid, my grandfather is a serial entrepreneur, man, one of the biggest hustlers on the planet. I love him. He's almost 90 years old. He's still at it. But he always told me, he said, you can work, you know, you can pay now and play later, or you can play now and pay later. And it always stuck out to me. I would rather pay now and play later than play now and pay later, so that I can enjoy the second half of my life a lot more than work in that second half.
Good. Mike, we got about a minute and a half left here before we got to jump off this.
Yeah.
Real quick, if you had to give one tip to a starting out entrepreneur, what would it be? And you may have already said it, but.
Yeah, I think, I give two tips. Take your time, first and foremost, and secondly, surround yourself with people who believe in you. Because it's going to get hard, it's going to get tough, and you're going to need people who are going to stand with you through the thick and the thin. So, you know, stick with people that support you and take your time. Don't be in a hurry. You got your whole life ahead of you. There's no need. There is no such thing as an overnight success. So don't believe that lie and just go. Just one foot in front of the other and keep moving.
You're right. And we're going to link all of your social media channels, everything down there in the descriptions. Of the podcast, whether you're listening from audio or you're watching video here, we're going to link your website. Guys, check out Mike's stuff. This guy is really, really intelligent. He's really smart with what he puts out there. If you've listened all the way through here to this video or this podcast, like, you can see he's a sharp dude. You just got to connect with him one-on-one yourself. This guy is definitely one to follow. Like, if you want to follow a real entrepreneur, follow him. But thanks for being on, Mike. I really, really appreciate it. Maybe we'll reconnect here in the future. But we got to run for now. I know you said you had to get out of here too. So thanks for being on, man.
All right, dude. Hey, thanks, bro. I appreciate it. Have a good day.
Thanks for watching the show, guys. Honestly, I really appreciate all the feedback I've been getting. If you haven't been giving me any feedback, it really, really helps me. It shows the search engines that people are actually engaging with my content. So if you did like what I had to say today, go ahead and give me a big thumbs up and a like. If you didn't like what I had to say today, give me a big thumbs down or a dislike, because either way, honestly, it helps the show out. It shows the search engines, like I said, that people are engaging with our content. And furthermore, if you really like what we have to say, make sure to subscribe here to the show. Subscribe to it, engage with the content, leave a comment, leave a like, share it with somebody else. Help us get the message out there, guys. This is a completely free show. I don't charge for any of my content, so all the help I can get, I really, really appreciate it. But make sure you stay tuned, guys, because next week's episode may be even better than this week's episode, so make sure you check it out. I record these in advance, so I definitely know that every single week, what's going to be coming, what's not going to be coming. But make sure you check this one out, because next week's episode is really, really good, guys. I have some really good points to get in there, and I got a really special guest on there that you're probably not expecting. So make sure to go over and check that show out, because I promise you, you're going to pull some insane keys out of that one, guys. But until then, we'll see you next time.